My name is Scott Kleinert. I'm with True Commerce, one of the sponsors of today's event. And I have the pleasure of introducing our next speaker, Jack Shaw. Jack is an innovation and technology strategist with over 30 years experience helping leaders transform their organizations to anticipate and manage strategic disruptions. Jack has advised key decision makers at such Fortune 500 organizations as Mercedes-Benz, Coca-Cola, Johnson & Johnson, IBM, Oracle, and SAP. His decades of experience designing, developing, and implementing emerging technologies enable him to speak with unique perspective on artificial intelligence, blockchain, 5G, and the Internet of Things. Jack integrates his executive experience in industry, technology, and consulting to speak on innovation, change management, and transformational leadership. A global thought leader, he was voted one of the world's top 25 professional speakers and one of the top five technology futurists. Jack has shared his insights and advice with nearly 300,000 of the world's top leaders and professionals in 26 countries and in every state. He's a Yale University graduate with an MBA from Kellogg. Jack, welcome.
All right. Thank you very much. As an innovation and technology strategist, I have often been asked to share my thoughts about the future of business and technology. And whenever I do, I always try to keep in mind the wisdom of that great American philosopher, Yogi Berra, who put it so well when he said that making predictions is very hard, especially about the future. Nevertheless, I'm going out on a limb this afternoon. I'm going to make a few predictions. So please join me on a short trip to the near future. The latest generation of passenger jet pauses for a moment at the end of the runway at Charles de Gaulle Airport in Paris prior to being cleared for a non-stop transatlantic flight to Pearson International Airport in Toronto. Several hours later, far over the North Atlantic, an Internet of Things sensor embedded in one of its key electrical components detects that the component has begun to behave erratically. Now, this is not an immediate emergency, but the part will have to be replaced on arrival at Pearson prior to any return flight to Paris. And here's the problem. This is a very expensive part that rarely, if ever, needs to be replaced between scheduled maintenance. And so it's not kept in on-hand inventory at Pearson. Now, in years past, like say back in 2020, this would have meant having to take the aircraft out of service for several hours, perhaps even a day or more, while the part was procured, at great expense to the airline and great inconvenience to its passengers. But no longer. Instead, the airline's smart warehousing system from Texas launches an intelligent procurement agent onto the internet. It searches the Idea Connector database and other sources for current and prospective new suppliers of that part, certified for use on this particular aircraft. It identifies several such suppliers and confirms their quality, reliability, and conflict-free green sustainability through a blockchain-enabled sourcing system from Distributed Ledger Technologies. It then negotiates pricing, terms, and conditions, selects a supplier, adds it to its supply, a new one in this case, adds it to its supplier database, and confirms an online, legally enforceable smart contract with that new supplier. On completion of the smart contract, the supplier issues a picking order and sends a shipping order to Raydan Freight Services to confirm delivery of the part to Pearson prior to the arrival of the aircraft from Paris. The elapsed time between identification of the problem by the airline's Internet of Things sensor and the issuance of the pick and ship orders by the new supplier is a grand total of 4 minutes. The part is delivered to the gate an hour before the aircraft arrives, while the aircraft is being serviced. The part is replaced, and the aircraft departs on time without a single minute's delay, and with a new electrical component in place to ensure many more safe and reliable international round trips. Now, this may not be exactly how you and your customers are managing major equipment maintenance and parts replacement today. But with emerging technologies and capabilities from solution providers like Texas, IDEA, Distributed Ledger Technologies, and Radan Freight Services, and some of their competitors, these are exactly the kinds of things that you're likely to be doing in the near future. This is all part of what is often referred to as digital transformation. And when applied more specifically to manufacturing and distribution, it's often also referred to as Industry 4.0. In addition to some of the technologies that I've already mentioned, Industry 4.0 includes such things as robotics, augmented reality, and additive manufacturing, or 3D printing. Perhaps one of the most important is AI, and AI is often mistakenly thought of as something completely new and very different from what we've ever done before. In fact, it's just on a continuum from data analytics that we've been doing for years, decades in many cases. Starting out with descriptive analytics, what used to be referred to as business intelligence. What happened? Only bringing the information about the status of your business up to date from, say, weeks or months ago to minutes or seconds ago. Descriptive analytics then segues into predictive analytics, where you look at the trends and project forward to see what's likely to happen in the near future. And that in turn, and this is where we begin to think of it more as AI enabled using tools like machine learning, but also many others, is to go into what's called prescriptive analytics. In other words, determining what needs to be done to achieve a desirable outcome, given the likelihood of what appears to be happening in the near future. So as we move forward, you can imagine that we will see AIs that are so clever that they'll allow you to do automatically such things as schedule production based on maximum machine performance, monitor the performance data for each piece of equipment, assign the right technician to the right task at a point in time, and even predict product sales trends that haven't been noticed by people yet. So you're making or distributing more of what is selling or what will likely be selling in the very near future. Now, another transformational technology, which Mark Dancer mentioned earlier, and which I touched on very briefly, is blockchain. And because the first live production systems using blockchain technology were Bitcoin and digital currencies, many people are under the misconception that that's all blockchain is about. And in fact, that's a relatively insignificant part of what blockchain will be doing for us in the very near future. For manufacturers and distributors, supply chain is a much more important application of blockchain technology. In fact, in a study recently published by PricewaterhouseCoopers, they project by the end of this decade, blockchain technologies, blockchain-enabled supply ecosystems will add nearly $1 trillion US dollars per year to the global economic product. Let's take a look at how this is going to happen. One of the challenges we have with supply ecosystems today is that we have manufacturers, distributors, transportation carriers, retailers, and customers all communicating with each other. And frequently that communication does take place electronically, but it's stepwise, one tier at a time, up and down the supply chain. And the result is that you often have information that is delayed, inaccurate, or in some cases missing altogether when various participants need to be able to make decisions. Blockchain changes this parameter completely. And instead, you have all the same participants in your supply ecosystem. But instead of each having their own siloed set of data periodically updated by other participants, one or two layers above or below them in the supply chain, they all share a common pool of secure information across the blockchain. Everyone, as soon as anyone does anything that affects anything or anyone else in the supply chain, everyone who is authorized to see that information can see it immediately. Now, we would not authorize direct competitors, for example, to see price quotes to the same customer, but we would authorize people to see information about the availability and locations of inventory, the timing of deliveries and so forth that are going to affect the decisions that they need to be able to make. And this kind of common data pool across the supply ecosystem as a whole is exactly the kind of tool that we need to have in place in order to be able to resolve a lot of the kinds of issues that the customer spoke about in the previous segment that took place prior to the break. Those of you that go into the breakout session after my presentation by Distributed Ledger Technologies will learn about a very exciting application that they worked with to set up for Walmart of Canada, saving millions of dollars a year on freight invoice disputes as a result of implementing blockchain technology. And they'll give you the details on how that works if you're going to be in that session. Now, one of the artifacts that you can have on a blockchain is what's called a smart contract. It's a computer program that can run on a blockchain and can take custody over assets on that blockchain, such as, for example, funds set aside in anticipation of successful completion of a business deal or transaction. It can track what has happened to date, incoming transactions information and events such as shipping or deliveries, and can then respond to that incoming information or events by updating transactions or events as may need to take place. Another example of how blockchain technology is being used in supply chain is by tracking provenance. Now, some of you may recall a couple of years ago when most of the supermarkets in North America had to pull all of the romaine lettuce off of their shelves, hundreds of millions of dollars worth of product thrown away. The reason was very simple. They didn't know where that lettuce had come from and where the lettuce that originated in the location was shipping out product tainted with E. coli had ended up. It was taking nearly a week to track that information. Obviously, you can't wait a week to make a decision about potentially life or death circumstances. By implementing blockchain technology, Walmart now is working with all of its customers and many, many other retailers around the world are also doing the same thing. They reduce the time from almost a week to less than 2 seconds to track the source of the tainted product and then where that tainted product was distributed so that the locations that had the tainted product could throw that away, but all of the others, 98%+, were perfectly safe. The same principle applies whether we're talking about faulty parts, whether we're talking about other types of problems with products or services, parts, materials, that sort of thing. And again, this is part of the reason, along with the increased traceability and visibility that blockchain provides, why PwC sees it saving literally trillions of dollars a year around the world moving forward. So between technologies like artificial intelligence and blockchain, in addition to all the others that we've mentioned, we have some very exciting opportunities moving forward. But none of this really matters unless you have a broader, innovative planning process for anticipating and managing strategic disruptions. By strategic disruptions, I mean such things as pandemics, like the COVID-19 pandemic we're all too familiar with, but also things like climate change, hurricanes, wildfires that are being caused by that, geopolitical disruptions like trade wars and unexpected tariffs disrupting supply chains, even emerging technologies themselves, social media, as well as AI, blockchain, 3D printing, and so forth, are going to have strategically disruptive impacts on many different industries. And one of the challenges is that a lot of people have said, well, how can you even develop a strategic plan that needs to look 2, 3, maybe 5 years into the future for a larger organization when something can come along like the pandemic or climate change and completely stand it on its head? What's the point? We might as well only plan for the next 60 to 90 days and then respond beyond that. There's an old famous saying in the military that the first casualty of war is the plan, and that's true if your strategic plan is one that is the typical static planning process where you get together for a couple of weeks during the fourth quarter, you make some projections about what's likely to happen next year, you make a few operational tweaks around the edges, and then you go on with business as usual, at least until something like the COVID pandemic comes along. But the military has been dealing with these issues for many years. And there is a better way of planning. It's called dynamic transformational planning. We've all heard the old saying, think globally, act locally. But at the same time with dynamic transformational planning, you also think long-term, act short-term. And what this means is that you start by establishing a set of goals, high-level strategic goals needed to execute your overall plan, to leverage your core competencies, resources, and capabilities in order to address the changing needs of the markets that you serve. And at the same time, ensure that you're addressing current and potential strategic threats and disruptions. Now, to achieve any goal, you need to have a plan. So dynamic transformational planning also incorporates plans. You can have more than one plan for a goal. So for example, keep a simple example here. Suppose that your goal is to drive home from work. This is assuming you're actually driving to work these days. You might choose plan A could be take the expressway, while plan B could be take surface streets. And each plan has its advantages and its disadvantages. And you may choose to change plans. For example, if there's an accident on the expressway, you might decide that you're going to go ahead and switch to the take surface streets plan. Now, in order to execute any particular plan, you need to achieve sub-goals. For example, if you're going to drive home, you need to have a car, you need to have gas in the car, a driver's license, and so forth. And to achieve those sub-goals, you may need to execute sub-plans. Now, this sounds rather theoretical when you look at it this way, but using a technique called the plan goal graph, you can see how this works. At the top, you have an overall plan and a series of goals you need to achieve to accomplish your overall plan. For each of those goals, you may have one or a combination of multiple plans that you can execute in order to achieve that particular goal. And in turn, for each of those sub-plans, you may have sub-goals that are required to be able to execute that sub-plan. Now, this all sounds a bit theoretical here, but let me give you some more practical business examples of this. You may have your overall dynamic transformational plan. It's likely to include some such things as have a workforce, have facilities, have technology, have revenue, address potential strategic disruptions. And if, for example, for have revenue, one of your plans is you're going to sell products. Okay, if you're going to sell products, then you have to have several goals. You have to have products, you have to have a marketing and sales of those products, and you have to be able to fulfill your orders. And if you're going to have a product, well, then there's a couple of different plans. You could buy products like a distributor does, or you could make products like a manufacturer does. Well, if you're going to make products, you have to have achieved a couple of goals. You have to have the parts, and you have to assemble the product. And in turn, to have the parts, one plan could be to buy the parts from a supplier. Another plan could be to make the parts yourself. Well, you can decompose all of these plans and goals down to individual primitive actions that work in your overall planning process. Now, at the same time, we now need to think a little bit about the planning phases for strategic disruptions. And as disruptions emerge, and this is information that is actually taken from the underlying principles used by the Center for Disease Control here in Atlanta, where I happen to live, for monitoring for disruptions. And it starts with the monitoring phase. Early in the process, you don't know what kind of strategic disruption you might have to deal with, what the likelihood of it is, the severity of its impact, what the timeframes are, other than that it's not immediate. That's the monitoring process. That's really what monitoring is about. But as you are monitoring for these items, you begin to identify somewhere you have a low to moderate uncertainty. The severity appears potentially higher, The timeframe may be a little nearer at hand. You may identify some specific potential disruptions. And this is where assessment and active planning come into play. Scenario planning, for example, can be a very important role in this process. Now, this is where many companies and countries were, and most should have been, certainly no later than January of this year with regard to the pandemic. Now, unfortunately, because of some of the political disruptions we had in the US at least, a lot of this got talked down and delayed for weeks or months beyond that point. But by the time you get to the third point, where it's moderate to high likelihood, the severity appears to be significant, we're now in a short to medium timeframe horizon, you better define the specific disruptions. Now you're into detailed operational plan. And certainly most businesses were at this point, say by April of this year. And finally, as it impinges on you directly, the likelihood is high, it's in the immediate or very near term horizon, that is where implementation planning and execution takes place. Interesting, I was talking to a fellow who had interviewed over 100 companies in Europe early in the pandemic and asked how many of them had strategic plans in place to allow for the potential of a pandemic. And out of the 100 different organizations that he interviewed, only one did. And that was the military, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. Everybody else had to start from scratch and figure out what to do. With NATO, they said, looks like we're getting hit with a pandemic. Throw a few switches for our pandemic strategy and adjust all of our strategic and operational plans accordingly. This is where we want to be able to be with businesses. In order to do this right, you've got to do, and this was mentioned during the earlier session, enterprise risk adjusted impact. You've got to look at both the likelihood and severity of potential disruptions. Now, obviously, if something is low likelihood and low severity, it's going to be a low priority for you to spend much time and effort addressing. At the same time, if something is high likelihood and high severity, we were certainly there by April and May of this year, that's an obvious high priority to address. One of the challenges that many companies have is they spend way too much time looking at the things that are high likelihood, but low severity. What would happen if a competitor came into our market and started competing with us for sales of certain product? Well, that really is something that should be part of operational planning. These kinds of things happen routinely, and we should be thinking about that, not putting a lot of focus on that. And unfortunately, not nearly enough attention is paid to those things that are low likelihood. But if they happen, suddenly tariffs are imposed and you can't get aluminum or steel imported anymore, destroying your supply chain. Hugely disruptive, maybe not very likely, but potentially hugely disruptive. And organizations need to at least have strategies and approaches in place to deal with these things. Now, in the real world, putting together a plan and goal graph typically means that you'd have one maybe 5 to 10 layers deep to facilitate your planning process. But with the right people involved, you could generally do this in just a few days. And it's important to assign variables to balance the relative values of the goals. I mean, you have a lot of goals you need to achieve to execute a higher level plan, but some are clearly more important than others. And at the same time, you have to assign variables to measure the costs associated with executing those plans and achieving those goals. It's also important to estimate the likelihood of your plan's success. This is where what's called Bayesian reasoning comes in. That's about considering contingent probabilities. And we're not going to get buried into the mathematics of how it works, but basically, instead of simply saying, well, what's the likelihood of X happening? It also allows you to address, if X were to happen, then what would be the likelihood of Y happening? For example, if a pandemic were to hit us, what would be the likelihood of the government shutting down our retail operations? After the fact, it's easy to see what that would be. Ahead of time, this is where contingent probability analysis can be extremely valuable. So the monitoring is something that's extremely important. To select the best plan, you've got to monitor your circumstances. Got to be setting aside some resources to look to the future. What if this or that or the other major strategic disruption were to impact us? How would we respond? This is why people use tools like Waze when you're looking at the traffic situation and trying to decide what route to take to get somewhere. It's also why it's important that organizations actively monitor for potential strategic disruptions and threats. Even if such strategic disruptions are not currently happening at a specific point in time. In my opinion, the worst mistake made by the US administration in dealing with this pandemic took place not since the beginning of the pandemic, but 18 months before it emerged. And that was when they shut down the Pandemic Monitoring Office under the National Security Administration. Therefore, when the pandemic did hit us, we had no plans or strategies in place for dealing with it. And we've seen the tragic results. So monitoring for strategic disruptions, pandemics are low likelihood, but obviously high impact. Climate change, high likelihood, but varied impacts across region and industry and so forth. Geopolitical disruptions, the likelihoods are varied, the impacts are varied, but they still have to be considered. And even the impact of monitoring for how emerging technologies may change businesses and industries. It's going to happen, very high likelihood, but the impacts will be varied depending on the industry, the region, the business processes involved, and so forth. So in summary, dynamic transformational planning means that businesses can think long-term and set strategic goals at the same time that they have the flexibility to shift dynamically in the short term and medium term in response to strategic disruptions. This allows them to address both anticipated and unanticipated strategic contingencies, such as opportunities, threats, and disruptions that may occur. Now, it's going to require significant change in the way we think about how we manage our business. It means that strategic planning cannot be a once a year project anymore. It's got to be an ongoing process. In my way of thinking, you need to have a minimum of 1% of your employees engaged in strategic planning on an ongoing basis, because it's going to cost you way, way more than 1% of your revenues or profits if you fail to respond effectively to strategic disruptions of the nature of the types that we've talked about. So you've not only got to think about how you might need to change your business model and your underlying business processes, even participate in changing the way that your ecosystem works, such as what I described in the aircraft electrical components example in the near future scenario at the beginning of my presentation. But most importantly, you've got to change your thought processes. And as the famed historian Henry Steele Commager said so well more than a century ago, change does not necessarily assure progress, but progress implacably requires change. I encourage you to make the changes in how you think about managing and planning for your business so that you can be successful in the future going forward. Now, unfortunately, we're not going to have time to take questions at the end of this session because we're going to need to move into the breakouts, and Swati will be jumping in here momentarily to manage that process. But my contact information is here. Please feel free to reach out to me by email, even by phone, if you'd like. I'd be happy to answer any questions you might have. Thanks so much. Over to you, Swati.
Thank you very, very much, Jack. That's, as always, a very, very inspirational. I especially, you know, the vision of the near future, I think, is important and sort of near and dear to most people on this today's call. Yes, a lot has changed in the last few months, and had we known last year what we know now or previously, I think we would all be in a little bit more of a preparedness mode. But thank you very, very much for those very informative and wise comments. And what I wanted to just stress to everybody as well is that this PowerPoint will be made available to everybody who has registered for the event. So again, please look out for that roundup email that'll be coming out within a week, with as well as this recording. So the